Hello, this is Linda Franz, and this is our second Inklingo live stream from Canada. It's Saturday night at 7 o'clock, and I didn't give you a lot of notice this time. I'm sorry, but I got an idea for what I wanted to do yesterday, and I couldn't wait. So here it is, and if you miss part of this, you'll be able to watch it later. So I am still getting used to all of this equipment, and it's even a little more complicated this time because I changed the setup of the cameras because I want to show different things this time. I've put a couple of hexagon quilts in the background, and I've got all kinds of hexagon talk for you tonight. Now, because I wanted to move the cameras around, I decided that I wouldn't do any printing tonight. I wanted to take the camera that had been on the printer and use it so I could show some close-up sewing. So it is a little bit different. So because I wasn't going to be printing live, I decided that I would do some printing last night and play it for you live. I hope you're going to see this. There you go. You can listen to me talk. This was last night. I just wanted to print a few sheets of hexagons with some fabrics that I could sew tonight. And you can see I've ironed the shiny side, the plastic side of the freezer paper to the right side of the fabric so we can print on the wrong side. And I just trim around with my scissors. There's nothing more complicated than that. I iron on both sides. This is a hot, dry iron, and that means the printer really can't tell the difference between printing this and printing paper. So I pop this in to the drawer in the printer. There are actually two drawers in this printer for putting paper in. This is the lower drawer, and I click to print. Now this was a custom page size that I set up last night to print 12 hexagons at a time. And I'm going to show that screen again. It is important to check the print preview screen so that you can be sure that if you wanted to print 12 hexagons, that's what you're getting. So here we have the first sheet of fabric printed, and I hope you can see the lines that are printed there. Some of the things that we'll be working with tonight, I've printed the lines even darker, just for the sake of the camera. Normally, it really doesn't matter. I can print very light lines, but for this, I want it a little bit darker. So in this case, I'm reusing that same piece of freezer paper to do the next sheet. And because I have the ironing board and the printer and the computer all in a sort of triangle in my normal setup, I can actually be ironing a piece of freezer paper to fabric while another sheet is printing and get a little bit of an assembly line going. So here's the second sheet. You can see I'm trimming so that with my non-scissors hand, I can pull on the fabric just a little bit so I get a nice clean cut. And again, I'm ironing on both sides of the freezer paper. So I'll just pause that for a minute. We might come back to it. But I'd like to show you what cameras we have tonight. The side camera is this one. And this, I've printed hexagons on this fabric. I'll be able to show you how I cut several layers at a time. And I also have a close-up camera. This is the one that would normally have been on the printer, but I wanted to have it on some sewing. And if you've been following Inklingo for a while, you know that I have several videos on YouTube already, and many of them are on the website as well. But the hexagon videos that I have, there is one for this is really funny. I have to stop. There is a delay between what I am saying and what is showing up on Facebook. And if I glance over and look at what's happening on Facebook, it really throws me off. Anyway, the videos that are already up on YouTube, and some of them on Facebook, some of them on the website, show how to sew hexagons by hand. And another one shows how to sew hexagons by machine. And tonight, I thought I'd throw a little curve and show you hexagons with hybrid piecing. And what I mean by this is that we sew some of the seams by hand to get the continuous stitching, the portability, all the things we love about hexagons. But I also sew some of the seams by machine to give me a fast start so that a hexagon quilt does not have to be a lifetime project. You can actually finish in a reasonable amount of time. So I'm going to try to get used to this new setup. I think we have, I'm going to check Facebook here. Oh, good. We have, thank you for joining us. We already have people from Janice from Kentucky. Oh, Kathy has already noticed the hexagon quilts behind me. Georgia, Karen, Sandy in Pennsylvania. Oh, and Orly is all ready to start a project after New Year's. Oh, this is great. I really feel more connected when I can get your feedback like this. Thank you for tuning in, Lori in Texas. And Butter Tart Karen is back again. Long Island, New York. Hi, Joanne. Oh, this is great. Betsy is back from Massachusetts. Some of you did watch the first video. I'm recognizing some names from that. And that's actually, I'm going to try not to repeat a lot of what I said in that first video. There were things like how Inklingo got its name, a couple of really good tips about using freezer paper, a little bit of a tour of the website and some of the really useful pages that I think everybody, whether you're experienced with Inklingo or just beginning, that everybody should be familiar with. So that's not what I'm talking about tonight. I'm going to show you more about hexagons. I'm going to show you some other pages on the website. I'm going to do some rotary cutting. I'm going to do some hand stitching, and I'm going to show you how I press hexagon flowers. That has been something that has been really intriguing to a lot of people. So I want to make sure I leave time at the end for that. I've already got the iron heating up. So just to get started, when I wrote to a few friends and told them that I was planning to do hexagons, they kindly sent me some photographs of some quilts that I can share with you that they've made with Inklingo. And let me start. This one, the first one I'm showing, is by Kathy in Mexico. Kathy and I became friends back in Dear Jane days. And we've met in person, not in Tennessee, where she's originally from, and not in Ontario, where I live, but in Washington State out on the West Coast. So Kathy made this with Inklingo. She printed all of the hexagons for this. And she also, isn't it lovely? I really like this. Kathy is very creative, and some of you who know her know how amazing she is with fussy cutting. I call her the queen of fussy cutting. And I have another one here of Kathy's. That's not the one I meant. That's a great quilt, but this was Kathy's as well. And she wrote to me about this. I'm just going to read what she wrote. She says, "This is a top that I pieced while all of our furniture and my fabric was in storage." This was when she moved to Mexico. "It is totally hand-pieced and all printed with Inklingo. These pieces were scraps from all my other projects. The only thing I had to work on for 3 months. I finished it and had to resort to crocheting until I had my stash back. Isn't that funny? Just these are scraps that she printed with Inklingo, and this kept her busy for 3 months. I think it's beautiful. And this kind of quilt is kind of intriguing too, because I'm sure when Kathy looks at this, all of her scraps from her other projects mean something to her. That's a really special quilt. And Kathy in Toronto has also sent me photographs of hexagon quilts that she's made with Inklingo. I absolutely love this one. Let's see if I can make it just a bit bigger so you can see some of the detail. These are elongated hexagons in this one. Aren't those colors beautiful? And here's another one of Kathy's. This is with the embroidery butterflies. This is Emma's Butterfly Stars, which you can find on the website. And another one of Kathy's. Now, one thing you want to notice here is Kathy's blog. If you've been following the All About Inklingo blog or even the website, then you know about the Quilt Obsession blog. Kathy has posted fabulous Inklingo quilts. So this one has hexagons with the star point, two sizes of hexagons in this one. This blue and white quilt is, it's been popular with everybody. So, okay, so I've got more quilt photos to show you as you go along, but I think right now I'd like to show you some of the rotary cutting. Now, this particular, I'll switch cameras, and I hope I've printed the lines dark enough for you to see. This is darker than I would normally print this fabric, but I was really trying to get lines that you would be able to see for the rotary cutting. Now, I'm going to stand up to do the rotary cutting and hope that I don't knock over any of the cameras. And the first thing I do, of course, is peel off the freezer paper. I can use this again and again and again and again, but I don't want to cut through it. I just want to cut the fabric right now. So here we go. I'm watching the camera to try to make sure that you can see what I'm doing. What I've done here on the edge is I've planted the rotary cutter on the line, then I slide the ruler into position so that I'm not measuring, I'm not wiggling with the template, I'm not reading anything on the ruler. And if you get the free diamond triangle square shape collection, there's information on rotary cutting with Inklingo. Am I still in the camera view? And it explains why I think this is much safer, because we're planting the blade before we move the ruler into position and we're not distracted by trying to measure. Okay, I'll move this over so you can see it. Now, if you know how, you might want to enlarge the video on Facebook so that you can view full screen, so that you can really see these lines. Okay, now what I like to do with this, you can obviously cut these now with the rotary cutter, all the lines are there, but you can actually cut several layers at a time by just peeking to make sure that they're lined up the same. So if you haven't done this before, I recommend starting by cutting two layers at a time, and before long I think you'll be cutting three or four layers at a time. Now, I'm just going to move that to show you. So I plant the blade first, then I move the ruler into position so that I can cut on the line. Now here, you can see I was just slightly off in the way that I cut that, but it really doesn't matter because I will be following the sewing line, and the cutting line really doesn't make any difference. Now, if you're really, really fussy, you can cut single layers. But I really think if you try it once, you will be cutting several layers at a time before you know it. So last night, so I'm not going to cut all of those, because last night, here we've got some scraps. Last night I printed a few sheets of freezer paper and got a bunch of, is that going out of focus? I hope not. And we have stacks of these that I can sew tonight. So I hope you were able to see that. I'm sitting down again. I haven't knocked any cameras over yet. Let's see. Okay. Now I'm checking in on Facebook again. West Virginia, hi, Carol. Oh, I'm so glad so many of you were able to show up tonight, because as I say, it's less than 24 hours since I announced that I would be doing this, and I wasn't really sure anybody would be here. But thank you. I really appreciate this. Okay. I'm not sure which is the most recent comment and which is the... I guess it doesn't matter. Just thank you for being here. Okay. Now, as I say, I have hexagons cut and ready to sew. So I'm going to switch now to the close-up camera and show you a few things about hand piecing these. I wear my, oh good, you can see that. I wear my finger pin cushion. All I have in it is two needles. One I've already threaded, and the other one I'm going to use like a pin. I don't need a box of pins, and this makes my sewing kit much more portable. These are all old tips that I've been sharing for years. So I'm going to put a little tiny knot, here we go, in the thread at the end. I just wrap it, pinch it, and pull, and I get a little teeny tiny, I'll hold it against the red. Can you see how tiny that knot is? That's my quilter's knot, and I'm ready to go. Now, for this, all I need to do is lay the pieces out wrong side up like this, and I can do quite a bit of continuous stitching this way. Now, this is one of the tips that is in the Hexagon Quilt Design Book, with the sewing instructions. But what I want to do is always sew at least two seams before I break the thread. So for example, if I sew this seam, I can then sew this seam before I have to break the thread. Then once those two are sewn, I can sew this one and keep going around. Now, there are illustrations for this in the Hexagon Quilt Design Book, which I'll just show you now. Let's see. How do I get to that? Okay. No, that's not what I wanted. I wanted this one. Okay, this is one of the pages from the Hexagon Quilt Design Book. And this design book, there is a difference. Here's a little tip. There is a difference between shape collections and design books. A design book has design ideas and the how-to, like the sewing instructions, the assembly instructions, the pressing instructions, anything you would need to actually make the quilt. And in the early days, like in 2006, 2007, I would put all the instructions in with the shapes. But then with the hexagons, I realized I was doing many sizes of hexagons, and it seemed silly to put the same instructions in with every single shape collection. You really only needed them once. So the shape collections have the shapes to print on fabric, And the design books have the instructions. In some cases, when there's only one size of something, like ribbon flower was a new one that I did last spring, there's only one size for that, so all the instructions are in with the shape collection. But in this case, for hexagons, if you buy any hexagons and some of the other shapes, you get this hexagon quilt design book, and it is full of good stuff. Let's see if I can take you on a little tour here. Okay, here's a good thing. This shows, there are a couple of pages here that show you how to count hexagons. If you've just drawn something up yourself or created something, you know, from a magazine, something that you want to adapt, how you can count the number of shapes that you need from each fabric so that you can use Inklingo to tell you how much fabric you need. There are worksheets in the shape collection. Let's see if this works. Okay, can you see that little flashing circle? That's so that I can show you where the cursor is. I'm advancing through the pages here. This is Monkey's cheat sheet, where you would record how many hexagons you need from a particular fabric, and Inklingo tells you how much fabric you need for that number of hexagons. This is something for designers. You don't have to be a professional, even if you're just designing your own quilt. And this is good information about how to use Inklingo with Electric Quilt software. So if you have Electric Quilt and you want to use all the wonderful current fabrics that are in it to design a hexagon quilt, there's information in the Hexagon Quilt Design Book to tell you how you can use that information with Inklingo. Let's see what else I have here. Well, there are just tons of design ideas and different quilts. A sample of a cheat sheet. This is the quilt I designed for the cover of the Hexagon Quilt Design Book. And another cheat sheet. So there's quite a lot in this design book. And it also includes instructions, including sewing by hand and sewing by machine. So, and this all goes together with the videos I mentioned on YouTube as well. So, hybrid piecing is what I want to talk about this time. And as I said, with hybrid piecing, you get the best of both worlds, in my opinion. You can sew some of the seams by machine, just sewing crosshair to crosshair, following the line that you've printed with Inklingo. And then when you need it to be portable or when you run out of time sewing by machine, you can sew the rest by hand. And that's what I want to show you tonight. So here, this is what I laid out, showing you how we would sew two seams at a time. But I'm actually not going to sew this one because I prepared something else this afternoon, and it is this. Okay, can you see? This is a hexagon flower. I like it for grandmother's flower garden with a hole in the middle. It still needs the center hexagon. And I sewed each of these seams by machine. I hope you can see that. I just sewed from crosshair to crosshair by machine all the way around. This actually worked well for chain piecing, and I end up with this. Now, again, with the pieces laid out wrong side up, I can start to add this hexagon to the center. So it's going to look like this. I think it's going to be very pretty. Okay, so let's see. This, I think, not only gives you an idea of hybrid piecing, but it also shows you continuous stitching, and I think I might even show you circling the intersection. So all I'm doing here is using my needle to pin, I hope this isn't going out of focus, to pin the far end of the seam, and now I can start at the beginning. And that went right through the crosshair. Can you see this? And I'm ready to sew this seam. I am hovered over this little camera here, which is not actually a recommended sewing position. You're supposed to have support for your arms. Anyway, I don't have support for my arms. Here we go. Now, as usual, when we're quilting, we sew a scant quarter inch seam. If the entire quilt is going to be one shape, all hexagons, you can actually sew on the line if you want to, because the difference will be the same in all of the shapes. So, two loads of the needle, and that seam is done. I take another little back stitch, and I'm ready to move to the next. I hope you can really see this. I was fiddling with lighting this afternoon and trying to make sure that I wouldn't be too close to the camera and that I wouldn't have too many shadows. But we'll see how it really looks. So now, here I am. I've finished this seam, and I want to get to this seam. So all I do is pass the needle through in the crosshair, and I'm ready to go again. So this is the second seam of the six to get this center hexagon. I'm just glancing up at the camera, and I think this is working. Okay, so these are 1-inch hexagons that I've got here. So basically, it's two loads of the needle. That's my first load. I think that was 4 stitches. Now I take a back stitch to start my next load. And I come up right in the crosshair. And that's another seam. It really makes such a difference. I know there are people who try to teach or try to learn how to sew dot to dot. And I think I'm pretty good with a needle and thread, but dot to dot is really beyond me. I need these lines to sew along. I love the results I get. So there, I've pinned this is the third seam. And again, just like before, I have to get from this seam that I just sewed through the crosshair to this one. And I'm ready to go again. Every seam, this is kind of a neat thing to learn because there's no difference whether you're sewing, you know, triangles or ribbon flower or clamshell. Every seam starts with 1 stitch and a back stitch. You take a load on the needle, a shorter load on curves, but usually you can take 3 to 5 stitches. I hope you're seeing that because I've got a really good view. I wish you had exactly my view. And when you load the needle again, you go in just behind to make a back stitch. And you end in the crosshair. This is the same no matter what shape. This happens to be hexagons, but it could be anything. And then I take a back stitch and that one is finished. How's that, eh? Oh, I said A. I guess you're going to know that I'm Canadian. And that's about it. I can't hide it. We laugh when we hear Canadians on TV making fun of our accents. There we go. I'm passing the needle through in the crosshair again. I think this is my 4th or 5th. Yeah, this is my 4th seam already. And start with 1 stitch, There we go. My back is killing me hunched over this camera. But normally I can get a very comfortable position at a table in our family room and so while we're watching TV. And it is important to get a comfortable position because you can end up with horrible things like carpal tunnel. I've heard of from a lot of quilters who get carpal tunnel or trigger thumb, I think it's called, from pinching for whip stitching. And I guess it can be very painful. And so a lot of people switch to a running stitch because it is easier on your wrists. Okay. So one more after this. Isn't this, you know, if I wasn't hunched over this camera, I would say that this is very relaxing and therapeutic. Let's see. You can see I can always check the back and make sure that I'm right in the crosshair. And that makes this very, very precise. And I actually printed these lines a little bit darker than I would normally for a fabric like this. Again, just for the camera. I like to use the least amount of ink that I can. Okay, there's... And I finish with the back stitch. As soon as I finish this last seam, I'm going to have a look at Facebook again and see if you've left me any more comments. So this is the last one. I think this is going to be very pretty. Okay, so I've passed the needle through, and as I say, this is just very repetitive and relaxing. This is a very strong seam, which if you're ever wondering how strong this seam is, just try ripping it sometime. You know, make a boo-boo on purpose and see what you think of the strength of these seams. Okay, so again, I finish with a back stitch. And so that was all done with one thread. And let's have a look. I think that's kind of pretty. I just picked the green hexagons that seem to have some yellow near the center, and I think it kind of worked. It's got a lot of movement to it. So this is how your hexagons look when you're finished, because unlike machine piecing, we don't have to press as we go. So here we go. All right, I'm going to have a look here and see who's joined us. My eyes are slow adjusting to from hand piecing close up to trying to read the screen. So I guess that's my age showing. Okay, Betsy likes the colors. Okay, my eyes are coming into focus again. From BC, hello, Jeanette. I think last time we ended up with about 40 American states representative in the comments. Of course, I don't know where you are unless you leave a comment. I love seeing the comments. And so near the end, by the end, when people had written on the blog and watched the encore presentation, I think 40 American states were represented, and I think almost every Canadian province as well. And there was a whole list of countries and some kind of unlikely places that I listed on the blog when I showed the encore presentation. So this video will be available if you've missed part of it, we will be replaying on the blog. I probably won't be able to get it up tomorrow, but maybe on Monday. Okay. Oh, I love it when you leave the comments. Thank you. Okay, there's Joan says she doesn't have an inkjet printer. Now that's, I hear that fairly often, either from people who don't have a printer at all or from people who have switched to laser for some reason. And the good news is that for Inklingo, you can use whatever is on sale. And people have written to me telling me that they've been able to find suitable inkjet printers on sale for $30 to $50. And when you compare that to a lot of other quilting tools, that's really pretty reasonable. And of course, Inklingo uses a tiny amount of ink, so you could probably print a whole bed quilt with Inklingo with less ink than you would use just to print a few photos. So the cost of the ink is, you know, really not a big factor. And if you do have a laser printer, you should never put freezer paper in it. But you can have an inkjet printer attached to your computer at the same time. And there's some quite small ones if shape is a, or if size is a consideration. I know I don't have room for another printer. Okay. Oh, Merry Christmas to you too, Tony. And Anne is here from Oklahoma. Oh, thank you, Agnes. That's good. Okay, I'm loving getting these comments. There was really good feedback after the first video, even though I kind of got lost my way with switching cameras, and the sound did break up. I'm hoping it's not breaking up this time, because we've added all kinds of equipment. The tower now has more RAM. It has more USB ports, so that the printer, you might remember from the first video, the print dialog box sort of froze for maybe 20 seconds. And now that doesn't happen when I do the printing, because we're able to have the cameras and the printer and all of the other equipment on separate USB controllers. Don't ask me. I don't understand any of it, but Charles has helped me with that. So Charles has been helping me for probably 15, 18 years now. I totally trust his judgment. So there we go. Now I think what I'd like to do is get the iron heated up, and I'm going to show you a couple of things on the screen. Next. Let me find this. Okay. This is from the 60 degree hexagon 1-inch shape collection. And when you open it, any shape collection, you're probably going to get this panel on the right, but there's a little arrow about halfway down the screen where my cursor is now. You can see that circle flashing. If you click on that, you get the whole screen. You can drag the panel on the left, oops, to be wider if you want, or narrower. And you can go, here is the description page for hexagons. And it's consistent in all the shape collections. The next page gives you the custom page sizes. So here you can see, I'm going to just zoom in on that so that you can see all the different sizes. If you know you want 6 hexagons, which is fairly common to go around a center for a flower, you would print 5.75 by 7.5 landscape. If you want as many as you can print all at once, you would get 15 at a time and print 8.25 by 12. So that's an example of why we don't just have pages that are 8.5 by 11 or A4, because we actually have all this flexibility. And this page also shows you how many you can expect to get from a yard of fabric. So 225 if you print 15 sheets of 15. Okay, now while I'm going to put up some of the photos again, let's see, there is Kathy's quilt, one of hers, and here's another one. Yeah, this is another one of Kathy's, and this is a cool one because she has used partial hexagons around the white hexagons. Those are half hexagons, and those are included in every hexagon shape collection includes partial hexagons. So in the background here, while you're looking at that, I am trying to set up the iron so that I can, and everything's falling down. Okay, I'm setting up the iron so that I can show you how I had such a good plan for making this easy to do, and it's okay, I think we're all right. I'm glad you didn't see that. And here's another one of Kathy's. Now this one, I hope you can, isn't that a lovely photo with the impatience? I'm going to zoom in on that too. You can see these are hexagons. This is Kathy in Toronto, and this is Vals Brion from Mille Fiori Quilts. And these two shapes plus the center hexagon make the bigger hexagon, and you get this ribbon effect. Kathy actually called this a ribbon flower. Okay, now here we go. I think the iron is almost ready. And okay, I've moved everything around. We've got cameras fallen over, but this one is working. This is the flower that you just saw me sewing. Again, the initial seams were done by machine, and we put the hexagon in the center by hand. And now I'm going to show you how to press it. I want to get this one, that's still not hot. Do you see how that has opened up? So that it actually forms a little hexagon on the back. And what it is this seam is going around clockwise. This one is clockwise. They're all going clockwise around that. So the trick to doing this, and it really is a pretty mild trick, I must say, is to look at one intersection at a time. So that one is done. It's perfect. But now when I want to look at this next intersection, I always move from one intersection to one that's adjacent. This one, this seam is already pressed to make this one so perfect. So this one, I have to go in the other direction. I have to go counterclockwise around the intersection. Okay. I hope you like the red background. I thought that was pretty good for Christmas. That's about as Christmassy as I get. Okay, so those two are done. Now I want to do the next one, the adjacent one. This one is already going this way, so that determines that this one is going to go clockwise. And I can just touch that with the iron too. And now again, this one is already determined that it must go this way to satisfy this intersection. So I'm going to go around this one counterclockwise. This is very hard to explain to somebody just in words. If you write a paragraph of this, it ends up, you know, sounding extremely confusing. But when you actually see it like this, I hope you can see the logic of it, because it works not just for hexagons, but for all kinds of situations. And it means that you have a perfectly pressed, let's see if you can see that, got a shadow on it from somewhere. I think I'm using every electrical outlet available in this room for lighting. And there you can see the back. So this one is going counterclockwise, the next one is going clockwise, and they're all just perfect little hexagons at the back. And that means every intersection looks its best on the front. So I've got another one ready here. I'm just going to show you that again. Starting by this one going clockwise. I use my big iron for this. Some people like to use a little iron. I never ever use steam. Actually, I had a good question from somebody today asking me what kind of iron I use. And basically, I use whatever is on sale because I don't use steam. I don't use steam in quilting, and I don't use steam for anything I do other than quilting. So it's, you know, that's not a factor. And things that I do want, like when I iron pillowcases, I spritz them with water, let it sit for maybe 2 minutes, and then I get a better press than I would ever get using steam from an iron. So that means you can spend less on an iron. And see how fast that is when you're not talking? I can spend less on an iron and more on fabric. Okay, so there are those two. Let's switch again. I'm going to sit down again and see what you've been saying. Oh, let's see. Oh, Sally and Kathy obviously know each other. I'm glad you came together. That's nice, friends. Karen, these hexagons are 1-inch hexagons. That means that each side is 1 inch. If you measure across the middle of a 1-inch hexagon, it's 2 inches from point to point. So that actually, I think, is probably the most popular size. From Delaware. Hi, Holly. Now, that's a small state. It's nice to know we've got somebody there. Oh, this is so nice. Singapore, thank you. That is lovely. I am so glad you tuned in. Now, I wonder what time it is right now in Singapore. You'll have to tell me. It is Saturday night here in Canada. Saturday night at about 7:47 p.m. Sue, I know, is in New Zealand. Colorado, hi, Judy. A lot of these names are so familiar, and I'm delighted that you've tuned in. New Mexico. Hi, Eugenia. Okay, yeah, that is a good point. The seams are very strong. Hi, Bert from Michigan. Oh, this is great. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in. Now I've got the iron in the way, and my cameras have fallen over. Maybe I can just show you a few more things on the screen. I'd like to show you, we just have a few minutes left. I don't want to go over an hour. That's really pushing it. So I think what I'd like to show you is the main hexagon page. Let's see if I can do this without burning myself. This is the main hexagon page. You get to the main page by going to this shop tab. See where I am in the top? So when you go to the shop and click there, I try to keep this as up to date as I can. It lists all the main pages. There are so many shape collections now that I can't list them all on one page. So they're sort of broken down into these groups. So here I go to the main hexagon page, and it gives a little bit of information at the beginning. That's an interesting thing. There are 8 good ways to use Inklingo for English paper piecing, if that's the way you like to sew. I actually hear very frequently from people who are switching from English paper piecing for a variety of reasons. But if you're using English paper piecing, Inklingo is great for you too. It wasn't what I intended. You can print your own papers with Inklingo. It tells you the yardage requirements. So you can see all the different hexagon shape collections. And when you, this is the same for any items in the shop. When you click on one of these, it takes you to more detail. So this has more information about the hexagon quilt design book. And let's see. On this page as well. Oh, this Vols Brillant was the one that Kathy did her ribbon flower with. And down here I have a couple of videos, well, actually three or four videos. This one shows, as I said when I was sewing, this technique works whether you're sewing full hexagons or just partial hexagons, or if you're doing triangles or diamonds or really any shape. It's the same thing. So that makes it very repetitive and relaxing and almost zen-like. You just get in the zone. So there's a video for that. There's a video here for a running stitch. This is the video here for sewing hexagons by machine, which was what I did today, and another one sewing by hand. And what I think I'll do now is show you some of these. This, you might want to watch this video on the main hexagon page. It shows hundreds of designs you can make with Inklingo. And Linda sent me this photo. She got the yellow fabric in the mail from me, and she printed the black and white fabric and sewed the two stars. She's new to Inklingo, and she told me she's going to put these two stars on her blog. And I'll put the link to her blog on mine when I post the encore presentation. You can see why I always recommend starting with the free shape collection. Main beginners page, I want you to take everything in the top line at least. If you want to know more detail, you just have to click on the covers. Sorry, that was my fault. I was talking and not showing you the right thing. But here, this is the video that I mean, that if you're not familiar with Inklingo or have never printed on fabric, that little video in only 8 minutes will tell you everything you need to know. Now that's me talking for an hour. I think I need a drink. It's Saturday night in Canada, and I'm tickled that you joined me. I'm going to check all of the comments now. If I haven't answered any questions that I find in the comments, I will either email you or answer you on Facebook, or I will try to answer them when I post this video on the blog. So again, just thank you very much for being here. I'm hoping to do this often now that I feel the equipment is up to snuff. I'm interested in your suggestions as far as when and what topics you'd like to see me talk about. I didn't mention the top 10 toots on the blog, but I'll go into that again next time. I've covered my list, my neat and tidy list. So I'll sign off now, and thank you very much for watching.